Great. Well, it's both an honor and actually a humbling experience to have the opportunity to follow that amazing lecture by Dr. Brunwald. And I've been given two difficult tasks today. One is to follow Dr. Brunwald, but also to fill in for my dad, who I apologize couldn't be here for some health reasons. But we live in a world where the delivery of slides is certainly easy enough, and I hopefully can deliver for you this talk just as he would have. We're going to spend a little bit of time talking about an overview of the disease, both the phenotypic expression and some highlights of some basic principles with regard to the clinical aspects of the disease. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is the most common genetic heart disease, with a prevalence of 1 in 500 in the population. And this prevalence has been reproduced in different continents, in different ethnic populations around the world, with almost the exact same prevalence. And if you apply the prevalence of 1 in 500 to a U.S. population, as an example, you're talking about 500,000 people in the U.S. with HCM. And if you consider about 10% of those patients at risk of adverse events, it's about 500 to 100,000 patients. That makes HCM an important disease for that fact alone. And how do patients come to clinical attention? Well, the most common reason is symptom onset, heart failure symptoms, shortness of breath, chest pain. But also, the second most common reason is the routine examination. Murmur, abnormal electrocardiogram, still important in the detection of this disease in the outpatient setting. I think one of the most important fundamental concepts to take home, I think, with regard to hypertrophic cardiomyopathy over the next several sessions is regarding the heterogeneity, both with regard to the phenotypic expression and the clinical course. And this is an example of what I mean by the phenotypic expression. And you can see here, through the eyes of magnetic resonance imaging, the most advanced imaging technique we have available today, where blood is bright, myocardium is dark, high spatial and temporal resolution. The contrast between blood and myocardium allows us to identify the pattern, extent, and distribution of hypertrophy. And as I think you can see and appreciate from these six different patients, an extremely diverse expression with regard to wall thickening in HCM, diffuse hypertrophy of the septum here, very focal limited hypertrophy in B, apical hypertrophy here, concentric, massive, and so forth. And of course, this diversity of the phenotypic expression is driven by the fact that this is a genetic disease, that the sarcomere mutations are responsible for this kind of heterogeneity. The diagnosis of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy has over the last several decades been largely within the domain of two-dimensional echocardiography. More recently, with the advent of newer sequences with magnetic resonance imaging, or CMR, we're now using this tool as an adjunctive imaging tool with regard to diagnosis and, in some cases, prognosis, which we'll talk about in a minute. And of course, with the advent of commercial genetic testing in most parts of the world, the ability to diagnose patients based on the mutation is now available. One of the important principles with regard to diagnosis now is the opportunity for CMR or MRI to identify areas of regional increased wall thickening that may be missed by echocardiography. Two of those areas of the LV chamber that are susceptible to being missed by echo are the anterior lateral wall and the apex. And you can see an example here of a focal area of increased wall thickness of 17 millimeters in the anterior lateral wall, not seen by echocardiography. The reason for that is the lower spatial resolution of this technique makes it difficult in some patients to delineate the lateral epicardial border of the myocardium from extracardiac structures. CMR, with its higher spatial resolution, is not limited by that technique and is a very good tool to identify hypertrophy when it remains ambiguous with echocardiography. Not only the anterior lateral wall, but the apex as well. Again, for those familiar with echocardiography, thoracic and pulmonary parenchyma, as well as issues of foreshortening, can make imaging of the endocardial border of the apex difficult. Those are not limitations by MRI. And you can see here a diagnosis of apical HCM made by MRI, where it was not by echocardiography. So the take-home message here, I think, in 2010, is when you don't feel comfortable having seen really well all areas of the LV myocardium. Moving on to magnetic resonance imaging to confirm or not a diagnosis is imperative. Now, with regard to the natural history of the disease, the majority of patients with HCM will develop left ventricular hypertrophy in the adolescent age group. Here are the bar graphs showing a change in wall thickness from predominantly normal to hypertrophy by the end of adolescence, so that by the end of adulthood, early 20s, the maximum wall thickness that you have is generally what you carry with you throughout your lifetime. Now, there are exceptions to that rule, and that includes the late onset LVH subgroup of patients. And so, although uncommon, this occurs, where you can have the development of the phenotype in the third or fourth decade of life. As you can see here, a woman at age 30 with a family history of HCM, whose echocardiography is negative, develops septal wall thickening 6 years later. And it's for this reason that the changes or recommendations to screening have changed to reflect the delayed onset patients. And this represents the current recommendations for the screening of family members with HCM. For those less than 12 years of age, echocardiographic screening is optional unless there are red flags, as you can see here, that would prompt earlier echocardiographic evaluation in those patients. For those that are in the adolescent period, echocardiographic screening every year and a half to detect the development of hypertrophy is recommended. And for those patients who reach 18 years of age without evidence of hypertrophy on echo, we screen every 5 years at that point up to about the third or fourth decade of life in order to detect a patient who may have delayed onset left ventricular hypertrophy. Now, as I said, hypertrophy begins generally in adolescence. The wall thickness that you're left with at early adulthood is what you carry with. There is a subgroup of patients, however, that develop adverse LV remodeling, the so-called end-stage phase or burned out hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. This is a subgroup of patients with HCM who develop ejection fractions, a systolic function of 50% or less. Again, this is a disease associated with hyperdynamic LV function where the EFs generally are around 60 to 65% or greater. So this is a real relative decrease. And it's driven by adverse remodeling associated often with cavity dilatation, septal wall thinning, and of course, the development often of heart failure symptoms. And this is what it looks like. Here's a patient in the mid-20s with a normal or typical phenotype. After a period of about 5 years, they develop the end-stage phase associated with systolic dysfunction, but also cavity dilatation, wall thinning. It's imperative that if you have a patient in the end-stage phase, that this subgroup of patients remains at higher risk of sudden death and potentially heart failure requiring transplantation. So we often bridge these patients with ICD therapy as well as changing medical therapy when systolic function occurs to other agents like afterload reduction with ACE inhibitor, aldosterone inhibitors to help improve the remodeling that is going on. Now, I think we heard a lot this morning about sarcomere protein mutations and their link with left ventricular hypertrophy in this disease, but there are a number of other disease features that cannot be easily explained by sarcomere mutations. And these features are part of the disease spectrum of HCM as well, and they deserve some attention. I want to focus for a minute on the subgroup of patients with this disease who develop LV apical aneurysms. This is an MRI image in the four-chamber long axis. You can see the wall thinning of the apex in the absence of epicardial coronary disease. These patients develop midventricular hypertrophy with midventricular obstruction. It's thought that the high apical systolic pressures that's created by this cause the adverse remodeling in some susceptible patients. Now, I'm showing you the subgroup because they don't do well. They have an adverse event rate of about 11% per year. That's almost double the adverse event rate of the typical HCM population. They suffer from arrhythmic complications like sudden death, ICD discharges, and that aneurysm also is a focus for thrombus formation and the risk of stroke. And so for this subgroup of patients, we often recommend ICD therapy and potentially Coumadin for stroke prophylaxis. And so identifying the subgroup is important because it raises those management considerations. And of course, MRI, again, with its ability to characterize the morphology of the apex very well, is another great technique for these patients. As you can see, an apical aneurysm identified by MRI, not seen by echocardiography. Now, the mitral valve, in addition, has been identified as abnormal or morphologically abnormal in this disease. It's elongated. And here's what I mean. Here are six different patients with HCM studied particularly or focused on the mitral valve leaflets. As you can see in panel A, an extremely long anterior leaflet of the mitral valve, almost three times as long as patients without HCM. A long posterior leaflet of the mitral valve here, both elongated anterior and posterior leaflet here, and so on. And so the mitral valve actually represents an independent morphologic abnormality in this disease, independent of other disease features like hypertrophy or left ventricular mass. And that's important because that really raises the issue of other mechanisms of disease expression other than the sarcomere that may explain this particular observation. Because as far as I know, there are no myocytes within the valves themselves. They are largely collagen and fibroblasts. From a clinical standpoint, the long anterior leaflets seen in this disease are important because they often make contact with the septum in obstructed patients much more distal than usual. And that's important because in a patient who's going to undergo surgical myectomy, that this may change surgical strategy, as I'm sure we'll hear about later on in the sessions. But the point is that an extended myectomy may not be enough. You may need to do a mitral valve repair with an Alfieri stitch in order to eliminate the systolic anterior motion that's produced by such a long leaflet. Now, that's a little bit about the phenotypic expression with regard to some of the important principles with regard to the clinical aspects of the disease. Probably the most important is that, in general, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is compatible with normal longevity. In other words, as a disease as a whole, survival is as good as an age and gender-matched population here in yellow from the United States. This is a mortality of living with any causes, cancer, accidents, and so forth. And as you can see, the survival curve for HCM doesn't differ from that curve at all. So as a disease as a whole, again, normal longevity for most patients. However, there are subgroups in this disease that remain at increased risk of adverse events. And those, of course, are the events that patients we want to focus on. Those at risk of sudden death, progressive heart failure. We talked about the end stage phase requiring transplantation. And of course, atrial fibrillation and stroke comes along with this disease as well. So to focus a minute on sudden cardiac death and its prevention, the mechanism of sudden death can be most appreciated by the understanding of the substrate and how abnormal the myocardial substrate is in this disease. I think you can see, and what we've talked about as well this morning, immense myocyte disarray can be seen and is seen in this disease as well. The intramural coronary arteries are structurally abnormal. They do not vasodilate well, and as a result, you get microvascular ischemia and burst ischemia, which results in replacement fibrosis, which you can see over here on the far right. And it's this abnormal substrate together which provides the nidus for the generation of ventricular arrhythmias when acted upon by a number of different stressors or triggers. Some we appreciate, such as here, and others that we may not even appreciate yet. And as a result, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is, in fact, the number one cause of sudden death in young competitive athletes, responsible for about a third of those deaths, at least in North America. The Italian experience, of course, differs, where ARVD is the most common cause of sudden death in young athletes. But as HCM as a whole, if you looked at the disease as a whole, with regard to the relationship to sudden death, as can be seen in the green bars here, the prevalence of sudden death is greatest in young patients, adolescents, and young adults. But these green bars do not disappear. And so there really is no age at which there is immunity to sudden death in this disease. So you can't tell a patient who's reached the age of 50 that they're not at risk at all of sudden death. These bars certainly drop down and decrease, but they do not go away. And for that reason, risk stratification is imperative. And in 2010, this is our strategy for risk stratification in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And of course, we're going to be spending more time talking in detail about these concepts. This is an overview, but this represents the current risk stratification profile in this disease. Of course, those patients with cardiac arrest or sustained VT are deserving of ICD for secondary prevention. What follows here are your primary risk factors for sudden death. And I think the major point, again, that we'll expand on later in the sessions is that any one of those risk factors may be enough to place a patient into a high-risk category to offer them ICD for primary prevention. The other less conventional risk factors, again, as I mentioned before, those patients that develop the end-stage phase and the apical aneurysm patients should be considered for ICD therapy as well. Again, as I showed on the two slides ago, there are important triggers to ventricular arrhythmias in this disease that act on the substrate to lower the threshold for ventricular arrhythmias. One of those is intense, organized, competitive sports. And it's for that reason that the most recent Bethesda Conference and Expert Panel, number 36, has recommended and confirmed that athletes with an unequivocal diagnosis of HCM should not participate in most competitive sports. Those are HCM patients with or without obstruction, those with 15 millimeters or 50 millimeters. It doesn't matter. It all comes down to a diagnosis, an unequivocal diagnosis. And if so, the recommendation is exclusion from competitive sports to maintain the safety of that patient on the athletic field. Now, when we talk about symptoms, we really have to focus our efforts, certainly in the majority of patients, on outflow obstruction, and we're going to, again, talk a lot about this over the next day. But here is a still frame, parasternal long axis image of a patient with HCM. I think as you can appreciate here, systolic anterior motion of the anterior leaflet makes almost a 90-degree bend in mid-systole, making contact with the septum, causing impedance to blood flow, and as a result, a pressure gradient between the LV and the AO, which of course we can measure very reliably today with continuous wave Doppler techniques. So this is the mechanism of obstruction or subaortic obstruction in HCM. And it's been only fairly recently, although as you heard very elegantly by Dr. Brunwald, the disease has been a disease of obstruction for the last 50 years. The clinical significance of obstruction has only been more recently defined over the last decade. And here's one such study demonstrating that patients with obstruction defined as 30 millimeters of mercury or more, again, due to typical SAM septal contact, are much more likely to develop heart failure symptoms, heart failure death, and stroke than patients without obstruction, again, under resting conditions. And in multivariate analysis, just to emphasize obstruction, a very strong independent determinant of symptom and heart failure death. And not only at rest, but with provocation can we elicit gradients. And again, we'll talk in detail about this tomorrow. But here's a graph showing you a large cohort of HCM patients who arrive into the echo lab, non-obstructive, who undergo exercise testing with a routine Bruce protocol on a treadmill. And as you can see, an average of 50 millimeters of mercury post-exercise is the average gradient generated with exercise in these patients. And so exercise is a very important way to identify provocable obstruction in patients with HCM. And if you take a look at the disease in 2010, looking at data like I've showed you, and you were to look at those that entered the echo lab with resting obstruction and those that developed provocable obstruction with exercise, it is the majority of patients with HCM who have impedance to LV outflow and outflow tract obstruction. And this represents a little bit of a paradigm shift compared to our understanding of the disease in the 70s and early 80s when it was thought to be largely a disease of non-obstruction. And this is important because outflow obstruction changes management considerations for your patient. And here's what I mean in brief. For those patients with HCM who have symptoms, it is imperative to identify whether they are in the algorithm of non-obstructed or whether they are obstructed at rest or with exercise. Because as you can see, this creates a divergence in treatment strategies. Certain drugs like Norpace or disopyramide are only given to patients with outflow obstruction. And certainly patients with obstruction are only candidates for invasive septal reduction therapy like surgical myectomy or alternatively alcohol septal ablation. Likewise, truly non-obstructive patients are treated with beta blockers and calcium channel blockers if symptomatic. And unfortunately, there are no other invasive treatments for these patients, and therefore those that fail medical therapy with advanced heart failure symptoms become candidates for cardiac transplantation. Obstruction is such an important determinant of heart failure symptoms that when you get rid of it completely with either surgical myectomy or alcohol ablation, patients do very well. They have a reduction in symptoms that is often long-lasting, including the rest of their life, and survival is excellent. This is some data from the Mayo Clinic in orange here, the surgical myectomy patients. These are patients with advanced heart failure with obstruction who underwent surgical myectomy. And as I'm sure you'll hear throughout the next day, survival following myectomy is excellent. In fact, it doesn't differ from an age and gender matched US control population and may in fact provide a survival benefit compared to non-obstructive patients. And so obstruction really is in a sense a reversible form of heart failure for most patients. To move on lastly to touch on the where we stand today in the post-genome era in genetic testing. Over the last really 20 years, we now have identified 11 genes of the cardiac sarcomere that are responsible for HCM. And in fact, there are now over 1,000 different individual mutations that have been identified. So the genetic heterogeneity is really expansive in this disease. These are the 9 most common sarcomere mutations responsible for HCM. Certainly beta myosin heavy chain and cardiac myosin binding protein C, each accounting for 30 to 40% of HCM, are the 2 most common. Point is that these 9 mutations now encompass a commercial testing panel that you can actually order today on your patients to identify a mutation responsible for their disease. An important principle, though, is that at present, there really is no consistent relationship between genotype and phenotype, and in addition, mutation-specific outcome. So in other words, it's not possible to completely reliably predict one's phenotype based on their mutation, nor is it possible to make management considerations like ICD therapy solely based on the mutation as well. In addition, as was stated earlier, about 40 to 60% of patients who undergo testing have no mutation identified. This percentage will vary depending on the population and what you define as pathogenic for mutations. But certainly, anywhere from 30 to 50 is a reasonable number in which a mutation cannot be identified. For those that do have disease-causing sarcomere mutations identified, that certainly can aid in diagnosis. But I think most importantly, its role is in identifying family members at risk of developing HCM. And I think that's best exemplified here. For those in purple, they have HCM by echocardiography. ICDs are in place for 2 generations of people due to the high sudden death rate in this family. The question was, for the 14 and the 10-year-old, can you help us determine whether they're at risk of developing HCM? Their echoes are normal at that age, but they're about to enter puberty, a time when HCM is likely to develop over the next 10 years. Commercial testing with genetic testing identified a beta myosin heavy chain mutation in the 22-year-old. That allowed us the opportunity to test the children for that HCM disease-causing mutation, and they were gene negative, which means they are not at risk of developing HCM in the future. So a very powerful technique when applied in this particular situation. Of course, that also relieves them of the need for screening echocardiograms over the next decade or more. In addition, the permutation of genetic testing into the cardiovascular clinical community has now resulted in the identification of gene-positive, phenotype-negative HCM patients at greater and greater rates. And I think along with that is accumulating evidence to suggest that although these patients don't have left ventricular hypertrophy, the myocardial substrate may not be normal. And that is evidenced by the increase in serum fibrosis, as well as fibrosis by contrast-enhanced MR in this patient population, abnormal diastolic function by echocardiography, the identification of myocardial crypts in the myocardium, as I'll show you in a minute, and also the mitral valves are also elongated in these patients without left ventricular hypertrophy. Just as an example, I wanted to show you some evidence first presented by the Dutch group several years ago. These are some of our patients that were, in which we have identified myocardial crypts in gene-positive, phenotype-negative patients. These are blood-filled invaginations within the wall of the myocardium in patients that are family members who carry a gene but don't have hypertrophy. The clinical significance of these crypts remains uncertain, although they appear to be a marker for gene-positive status. From a clinical standpoint, with regard to the gene-positive, phenotype-negative patients, questions such as sudden death profile, management strategies, can patients like this play competitive sports, these issues generally still remain unresolved and will require more long-term follow-up to define better the natural history of these patients so that we can make much better recommendations about these issues in this particular subgroup of patients. And I'll stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marty. You've done beautifully. At this point, are there any questions from the floor? Professor Oghindi.
Would you like to theorize about the mechanism to improve the survival after myectomy? And will the indications for ICD change in patients who have been myectomized before?
Yeah, I think I think that the mechanism for why patients do so well after myectomy is probably due to the relief of the very high LV systolic pressures, which are probably not a good thing. They increase wall stress. They're probably a promoter of ischemia, as well as adverse remodeling potentially with fibrosis. And so by relieving that, I think that probably improves cardiac mechanics. It's been shown to improve my cardiac mechanics, and that's probably one reason why patients do really well. Whether indications for ICD will change after myectomy, I think that although the risk of sudden death remains low after myectomy, it's not zero. So I think the strategy to continue to risk stratify patients for sudden death even after myectomy probably won't change.
Yes.
Martin, do you suggest doing MRI for every patient with HOCM?
Absolutely. No. Well, I do in the sense of this. I think that we're at the point now where the ability to characterize the pattern and distribution of hypertrophy is really superior with MRI. So in my opinion, based on some of the data that I showed you, it would be very reasonable for a patient, at least on the initial evaluation, to undergo both echo and MRI.
Sudden death after septal ablation, does it decrease?
Right. Well, that's a great question. It remains, to some extent, uncertain. I mean, the follow-up of patients who have undergone alcohol ablation is still relatively short and will require longer follow-ups from the original cohorts from Europe who underwent alcohol ablation now out to 10 years. So whether it actually increases risk of sudden death remains unclear.
Okay. Thank you. Last question.
Thank you for this very elegant talk. And I was just wondering if you're totally against putting genetics in the risk stratification by the semi-final slide. Mm-hmm. At the moment, is it not at all included in risk stratification?
Yeah, I think.
Thank you.
Right. Good question. The question is genetics part of the recommendation for risk stratification? And at this point, no. I mean, it's not. In other words, we don't make decisions right now about ICD or high-risk status solely based on the mutations alone. With others? No. In general, no. In general, no. It's not part of the five primary risk factors right now, no. It may change with time, but at present, no.
Dr. Martin, you showed us a very elegant, thank you for a very elegant talk. You showed us a very good slide about the different abnormalities in genotype positive, phenotype negative family members, apart from left ventricular hypertrophy, obviously. Any role of ischemia, or has ischemia been shown in any of these patients or family members?
So the question is whether there's been any data about myocardial ischemia that would be present in genotype positive, phenotype negative patients. I'm not aware of any published data about that at all.
Has it been studied?
Whether it's currently being studied, I think yes, but whether there's any published data, I don't know. I don't know if you want to.
We're running up a little bit late, and we'll have time to discuss about this.
Sure.
Thank you, Mark.
Okay.